you doing? I just feel like God wants, I'm trying to just be led by the Spirit with all of this. So Tammy's going to open up with something first, and then we'll go through announcements, and then I'm going to share what God has put on my heart, and then we'll go right into worship. So Tammy wants to share.
I can't see over there. For some of you that have already heard me multiple times, you're going to say, all right, I got my own book. I don't want to hear anymore. But I bought this book written by Jonathan Kahn. It's his newest book, The Book of Mysteries. And it's told in the perspective, there's only two characters, a student and a teacher of mysteries. And each lesson, if you will, is just a page long. But I have found that it's kind of like one of the, I get through reading and it's like things that make you go, you know, you just kind of think about it and the Lord talks to you through it. And so I'm just going to quickly go through one that the Lord spoke to me in. And it says, it was morning. The teacher came to my room holding a little clay jar. A question, he said, can that which is little contain that which is big? No, I answered. Can that which is infinite encompass that which is, that which is finite encompass that which is infinite? No, I said again. But it can, he replied. How? He lifted the jar and he removed the cap from the top. It can, he said. It can if it's an open vessel. A closed vessel can never contain anything larger than its own size. But an open vessel has no limitations. It now can contain the blowing of the wind or the outpouring of the rain. It can even contain the flowing of a river. It would take a long time to contain a river. It could take forever, but the principle is the same. And the reason you're showing me this? Which is larger, that which you know or that which you don't know? Yeah. That which I don't know, I would think. So then it's only the why, it's only wise that you seek that which you don't know, I guess. But how do you contain that which is bigger than you, that which is bigger than your ability to comprehend? Being an open vessel, I said. Yes, said the teacher, only by opening yourself up can you come to know that which you don't already know. And only by becoming an open vessel can you contain that which is greater than yourself. The truth is always greater than our knowing. Your mind and your heart are finite clay jars. The truth has no end. God has no end. The eternal is infinite, always flowing. Like the river, I said. Yes, he said. But when the jar opens itself, it becomes unlimited. It can contain the waters of the river. So open your mind, your heart, and your life. For it is only the open vessel and an open heart that can contain the infinity of God. The mission, today, open your mind, your heart, and your life to that which you don't yet know, that you might contain that which is greater than yourself. And then it gives a few scriptures, and then I'll go on with what God told me. Isaiah 55, 1 through 9, I won't read the whole thing, but it talks about, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. That's just the last couple of verses of that. Jeremiah 33:3, call upon me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Yeah. And 2 Corinthians 4:7, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. And so as I was doing my and God was talking to me, he told me three things. First of all, we know that God is like the master potter. He forms each one of us. And I was thinking how the clay, the vessels, that is each one of us. Every one of us is a clay vessel. Everyone he's ever created is a clay vessel. and we were created in his image. So we too are potters informing the people or the pots in our life. We make impressions on them, but yet we're still learning. We're not the master potter. So, you know, I was thinking of pottery. I don't know a lot about it, but I know that if you're not very good at it, you can just totally mess it up, and it's really good for nothing but to throw back in the bucket. I mean, it's just, you can't fix it. And that's kind of like us. But yet he's the master potter, and what we think might need thrown back in the bucket, he can just ever so slightly, with just a slight nudge, turn it into something of perfection that, you know, that it was created to be. That was first what he showed me. And then second, as you think about the vessel, if you've done any dishes, I guess this is what I related to, like the raging river, God is supposed to flow through us like the river. And if you have a dirty jar and you pour water in it, the dirt just turns around inside the jar. But if you keep pouring that raging river or the water through, it starts to overflow, and little by little, what's inside is perfected, yes, and it becomes pure. So I guess what God was showing me is that, you know, we're not instantaneous. I mean, he sees us perfect, but we don't function perfectly right off the bat. I mean, if as long as we continue to move through him and let him flow through us, we become more and more like him, and we become that perfect vessel, and we're clean inside and out. And then the third thing that he showed me was, and I shared this, I think, with House of Prayer that night. If you take a jar, and it talks about the wind can fill the jar. If you've ever had a jar, whoo, and you blow across the top, it makes the sound. And it reminded me of when Suzanne preached 2 or 3 weeks ago. She said, you know, I never knew, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. She said, I never knew grace had a sound. But that's what I thought of when, if you remain an open vessel and that wind continues to move through you, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Yes, amen. Anyway.
That kind of goes in line with what the Lord revealed to me. So if we can just go through the announcements real quick, and speak the word first. So if you have a cell phone, please silence it or turn it off. And then we have a soup dinner on the 20th of November after service. Sign up sheet in the back? Or not yet? Okay. So if we just want to stand and speak the word and believe these truths, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord. So, if Toby and Donnie come take the offering. And Donnie, if you'd like to ask the blessing.
No, you all know what family calls me.
Sorry. Go on, sorry.
Go ahead. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be in your house this morning, Lord. We just pray that something great, we expect something great.
That's right.
Yes, yes, God.
We are full of expectation with what's going on in the world. The world seems to be coming apart, but we realize you told us all this was going to happen.
Glory.
To not be afraid or dismayed.
Glory.
But to put our faith and trust in you.
Yes.
We do. We believe and trust that you are in control of all things.
Yes.
So no matter what happens, you are in control.
Yes,
however elections go, however nations rise and fall, you know about it all and are in control of it all.
Yes.
And we just pray that you would bless this offering, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And keep us all alert.
Yes.
Keep us listening and watching and waiting and ready with expectation.
Yes.
Because we know that one of these days, that
Eastern sky is Lord. Thank you, God.
And in a time that we least expect it, you said you'll make your return. So let us be ready, vigilant, keep watching, and expecting.
Yes, God.
And we just pray that you'll bless the service,
bless
this offering, and all of us here, Lord. For we ask it in the name that is above every name.
Yes,
the name
Lord Jesus. Glory.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for your Spirit. Thank you for your goodness. So just like Tammy was saying, she was saying that God is the power. It's not us. It's He that is in us. So I'm basically going to spin off of what I shared last week about His word is true and it is faithful. So just for a moment, just take me here out of the equation and listen to His word. And He told me, He said, have the congregation even close their eyes and just breathe this in. So what He was saying to me is, look me up in the Bible and just see who I am. And I'm like, Lord, I feel like I know who you are. You know, you are the magnificent Alpha Omega. You are Lord. So He started revealing to me these things, and He says, the same power that made dry bones live, the same power that kept a man alive for 3 days and three nights in the belly of a great fish, the same power that allowed three men to enter a fiery furnace and not get a mark, the same power that shut the mouths of lions, the same power that slew a giant lives in us, the same power that calms a raging sea, the same power that commands the dead to wake, the same power that rose mountains when He spoke, the same power that made the maimed walk, the blind to see, and the deaf to hear lives in us. And the very same power that rose Jesus from the dead, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, He lives in us. Do we understand the power? I believe our identity has been skewed for so many years because of religion. I believe in this present time, God is telling us to arise and take our place in Him. Trust Him at His word. Don't let the enemy fool us or trick us into setting back. All of these powers that I just read are wrapped up into one, and His name is Jesus. And if He is dwelling in you, the power is there.
Yes.
We just have to walk in it and believe it and do it.
Yes.
So after He revealed these words to me, the song just kept coming to me and coming to me. And it was Break Every Chain. And I had asked Mike if he could please play that. And if you have a prayer need, come up. I will pray for you. There's other people that will pray for you. I just feel like there's a lot of chains in our lives that that weigh us down. It's the mind. They have chains. It weighs you down. Addictions. False hopes. But what God gave me a vision of is if you've watched a Hollywood movie where they've chained a prisoner and that prisoner gets up and breaks those chains, yes. That's what God wants to do for us. I mean, we need to carry him with us, not just today in this service. It's when you go out into your job. It's when you go out into the world.
Yeah.
That light, it needs to shine because these people are craving this spirit that is in them. God created their spirit also.
Yes.
And the minute you speak truth to that spirit, it knows. And something stirs in them. So I'm encouraging us all to come alive in him. Because it's the present time. It's these last days. It's what God wants us to do. We can't let the enemy chain us down, keep us blinded, steal the identity of who we truly are. So, Sheila, I don't know what... Oh, there we go. So, again, if the worship team wants to come forward, we'll just play this song. I just feel like God revealed it to me in the atmosphere, and when I'm hearing it, I can't stand still. So, it's like, if you guys need prayer, come forward. If not, he knows your heart. But just let this song penetrate your spirit. God, James, you need prayer?
Thank you.
there's somebody in the room that needs a healing of diabetes. So if you want to come forth, we let Brother Peter pray for you. He's been healed of that. So if you're struggling with that, come forward. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Come on, come on.
Mm-hmm.
Marker, Lord, in the day that the path has been straightened.
Yes.
this day be those who have been called and think that they were uncalled.
Yes, be recalled.
Yes.
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 Praise God. Praise the Lord. Let's all raise our hands and thank the Lord for what he's done in this service already. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for healing, for touching, for breaking the chains that bind, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you've done. Hallelujah, Jesus. Help us, Lord, to be aware and to claim the reality of who you are and what you do in our lives. We give you all the thanks and the praise for all the good that comes from your spirit, from your love. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you, Jody. Appreciate your sharing. And thanks, everybody. Amen for ministering one to another. Praise the Lord. I just say that, you know, what we experienced here this morning is an outpouring of love. Now you can call it healing. You can call it... you know, faith works by love. God is love.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit is the spirit of love.
Yes.
So when the Bible talks about Jesus having compassion on the multitudes, he was loving people, and the result of that love was healing. It was deliverance. It was breakthrough. It was whatever the need might be for that individual. That's what the spirit of love brings. Yes. And that's what I want to talk to you about this morning, is releasing the supernatural. We've already experienced it here.
Yes.
Amen. But I want to talk to you about it in a little bit different way. We've always kind of believed that we release it through, you know, some great faith or some, you know, power of ourselves that we've achieved through, you know, prolonged prayer and fasting and other things, which is nothing wrong with any of that. But I'm just saying this operates by love. God is love.
Yes.
And whenever you, that's why we try to get people to pray for one another. We want the testimonies. We want the sharing because it's showing love one for another.
Yes.
If the church is anything else, it's that. If it's not that, then it's nothing. It's just religion. And so I'm grateful and very pleased to see that love being shared.
Yes.
That's success as far as I'm concerned.
Yes.
In terms of serving God and loving God and ministering. So without taking any longer here in the let's just go right to the Word of God. I'd like to start, Sheila, in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8. Familiar to everybody, God is love. But I want to talk to you about this supernatural release in the context of, I believe to be the true context of how miracles happen, how healings take place, how the supernatural actually invades the natural. And it happens through us. It happens through we that are from another place, but stuck here in the natural.
Right.
But we're not natural people, we're supernatural.
Right.
We are spiritual people. We're people with God's life flowing through us.
Praise
Amen.
God.
So he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Romans chapter 8, and I want to read verses 29 through 39. Romans 8, 29 through 39. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Mm-hmm. He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us.
For I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus,
Amen.
Our Lord.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Amen. Now, you know, part of me, in fact, I think probably in all of us, there's this desire to earn God's love or to earn the Father's love. But the Father's love reflects the Father's character and not the children's behavior. I've said this before, but I'm just kind of setting this up a little bit. But our behavior, whether it's responsible or irresponsible, does not change God's love for us. We need to believe it.
Yes.
And I believe that what a difference that would make in our following Christ. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, follow me. And if we ever can get to the place where we understand God's unmerited love, God's complete commitment to us in love,
right,
our following Jesus wouldn't be the great task that we seem to think that it is at times.
Right.
Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. You know, I have all these debates about evolution and, you know, science versus religion. I don't even go there. I'm not really interested in the debate, because the creation story is completely misunderstood when you read it as science.
Right.
It ought to be understood as a love story.
Yes.
That's right.
If you pay attention to the imagery of the creation story itself, you can see this. Genesis 1, back up if you can, Sheila, and give me verses 1 and 2. In the beginning, you know, it says that the Word, or in the beginning,
was the Word. God created.
God, yeah, well, I'm not going back. There we go. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the earth was without form. So in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void. And darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. So it begins with the Spirit hovering over the unformed elements of creation.
Yes.
The image is of a bird protecting and maturing and nurturing her little ones.
Mm-hmm.
The life that she created. The life that's forming under her. I talked about the doves last week, come around our feeder and stuff, but this spring, Sally and I, we've got a couple of birdhouses. Well, we've got several birdhouses, but one's closest to the deck, and a crabapple tree that Wren makes her nest in it every year. And this year we watched her never leave that nest. Never. I mean, she never left. The male would bring food to her, but she wouldn't get off that nest. She'd stay there till gradually the babies begin to creep out. Or maybe that's creeping you out, but they got out. You know, they're coming out of their shell and they're moving around, but she never let them out of her sight. She continued to hover over them until they were able to fly, until they were able to go on their own. And that's the image of God that's presented in the Genesis story. Even in a shapeless state, the universe receives maternal, devoted attention from God. The Spirit hovering over the unformed earth is a picture of God's tenderness and his loving kindness and commitment. It's an important part of the creation story itself, that it's a love story. Verses 3 and 4 there, if you can drop on down, Sheila. And he creates the heavens and the earth. Let there be light. There was light. God saw the light. It was good. God divided the light from the darkness. Verses 9 and 10. God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called it seas. And God said, it was good. Verse 12. And the earth brought forth grass, herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind, and God saw that it was good. And so as the world comes into being, God, the Creator, pronounces each successive act of creation as good. Yeah. Amen? And that's just not an evaluation. It's an expression of love. Right. Amen? It's like you have a child, and you go, that's beautiful. It's good, right? Mm-hmm. God's love is the source and the fulfillment of all creation. Yes. Apart from the creative flow of God's love, there would be nothing but darkness, right, void, and non-being.
Right.
God's love is the source of everything that is, and that's especially true of humans.
Yes.
Genesis 1:31. God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Praise God. Very good. When he gets to man, the last of the creation, he says, that's very good. This is all good, but that is very good. Amen?
Yes.
Creation is an outpouring of love. Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Let's just look at this again quickly. So God created man in his own image. God is love. Creation declares that humans are born of love. Born for love. Created in the image of God who is love. Love is our source, and love is to be our fulfillment. We aren't just creatures of God. We aren't just creations of God. Creation was God's plan for friendship, for fellowship, for intimacy. We weren't brought into existence simply to worship God. We weren't brought into existence just to obey rules or to follow some particular doctrine. We exist because of God's desire for companionship. Does God need companionship? No, but he desires it. When God thinks of us, he feels deep, persistent longing.
Yes.
Not just for our wholeness, but for us.
Right.
For relationship. Genesis 3, verses 22 through 24. The Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil, and now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. So in all of us, there is a faint residue of the memory of the garden.
Yes.
That's the part of us, he says, he puts into every human being.
Yes.
To know that there is a God. To know that there's something more than all of this.
Mm-hmm.
And that's this faint knowledge or awareness of perfection of the garden and perfect love.
Yes.
And it remains the core of our deepest longings. John 3:16 says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Jesus came to remind us of our story, of what God created us to be, of how we are to be, of how our existence is supposed to be manifest. But really, encountering love isn't the same as asking Jesus into your heart, or joining a church, or following guidelines or rules. It's a whole other thing altogether. It's the experience of love that's transformational.
Right.
We talk about being transformed, but I'm telling you, scripturally, it is this experience of love, of God, who is love, that transforms us. Romans 8, 28 through 35. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Jesus, the Son of love. God is love. Jesus is the Son of love. And he came to show us the love that's our destiny, that's our healing, that's our fulfillment.
Yes.
You remember he said, he because they were created in God's image, he had to keep them, but once they understood the knowledge of good and evil, they're no longer innocent, he had to keep them from the tree of life. Mm-hmm. So that knowledge of good and evil couldn't be passed on from generation to generation. They were never going to die. Evil would be in the world forever. There would be no way of escaping it. Amen? Mm-hmm. Well, look at John 15:5. What I'm saying is Jesus is the tree of life. I am the vine. Mm-hmm. You are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Jesus is the source of God life,
yes.
Which is what the tree of life is all about. It's eternal life. It's God life.
Yes. Yes.
Jesus came to take us back to the garden to give us access to the tree of life. He is the tree of life. He is the source of God's love,
yes.
Forgiveness, and mercy, and all power, and eternal life.
Yes.
If we abide in him, we bear God's fruit. We bear the supernatural. Amen? He's the tree. He's the vine. We're the branches.
Yes.
He's made it possible for us to be grafted back to the tree of life where we came from, where we were supposed to exist eternally.
Yes.
In perfection. Without sickness, without disease, without
yes.
poverty, without ignorance, without all of that. So it's by love that we get it back.
Yes.
The Son of love came to give us access
yes.
back not only to the Father, but to life of the Father, to eternal life, the tree of God, the tree of life. Amen? So if God is love, he cannot be known outside of love. He cannot be known objectively. You can't observe God from a distance and know him. Religion tries to tell us that, but it's impossible. Without love, Jesus said, you can do nothing. Without love, Paul said, it's just a bunch of noise. So we can have a church service and somebody can, you know, declare and do all that. Without love, it doesn't mean a thing because it's only through the power of God's love, it's only through God, who is love, that the supernatural invades this planet, that gets into this place, praise the Lord. And we are children of God, given back to the tree of life, given the Son of love. Amen. Now we are sons and daughters of love, and it's through that love that we experience God and that we release God into other people's lives and into this world.
Yes. You
only encounter real love, divine love, up close and personal.
Right.
Oh, I've loved you from afar. No, you've liked me and you've observed me, but you haven't loved me until you get up close and really know me.
Right.
Praise the Lord. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 9. I really believe that, you know, this is the revelation. It comes by grace. We can't get to the love of God without grace. We're always being hindered by ourselves. But once we can come into the very presence of the love of God, experience the love of God, the result is that we share the love of God.
Yes.
God becomes real to people.
Yes.
Not only to other people, but to us.
Yes.
He's not some distant, far off, divine character of some kind, but he's life itself.
Yes.
Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God. Everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him.
Yes.
The tree of life.
Right.
God life. To know him is to love him.
Yes.
To know God is to experience love. First, as love received, as I said, and subsequently love returned.
Yes.
And released.
Amen.
Religion has confused thoughts about God with personal knowing of God.
Yes.
Religion confuses theology with spiritual experience. It's one thing to have theology. It's a whole other thing to have an experience in God.
Right.
We know people. We've known people. Maybe we ourselves were religious people.
Yeah.
We didn't know God. We knew the religion.
Right.
We were taught the religion. We were given catechisms. We were given all the things that you got to learn to know about your religion.
Yep.
But it doesn't make you any closer to God.
No.
It makes, yes, he's real, but so what?
Yeah.
Guinea pigs are real.
Right.
They're not from Guinea, and they're not pigs.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, it's like a boxing ring. It's not round. It's square. So we can have the verbiage, we can have, you know, words and language, but it doesn't mean a thing if you don't understand
right.
the God, if you don't have the experience of him.
Right.
Amen. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. Ephesians 3, 16 through 19. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. And to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with the fullness of God. That's the conversion that Paul is praying for us to experience.
Yes.
Not just a confession at an altar,
no. right.
but a genuine experience
right.
in God, for God to come alive.
Yes.
He comes alive through the Son of Love.
Yes.
All of us need to have our identity grounded
yep.
in being loved,
yes.
deeply loved
yes.
by our Creator,
yes.
by our Father.
Amen.
Back to Genesis chapter 5. Or excuse me, Genesis chapter 3, verses 5 through 10. Genesis 3, 5 through 10. See, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of love. And we've done everything to ignore it. I'm top of the list. Love makes me nervous. Love makes me uncomfortable. Talking about it is awkward. Why? Because my human gets in the way of the Spirit.
Right.
It ought to be the most natural thing. And I'm not talking about smarmy, sloppy, yeah. slobbering. I'm talking about releasing what real love is.
Right. Yes.
We got all kinds of ideas about what love is. And I'm telling you, God is love.
Yes. Exactly.
For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes will be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, this is the tree of knowledge of good and evil, tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And before I go on any further, let me just tell you, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was a substitute for the tree of life.
Right.
Yes.
If I know more, then I'll be everything I need to be. And God is saying, that's that tree you don't want to even mess with. The only tree you need to be concerned about is the tree of life.
Right.
Love. Yes. More knowledge is not going to change anything for anybody in terms of our relationship with God. It's an experience we have to have.
Exactly.
So they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. Now, let me just go a little further with the knowledge of good and evil, the tree. See, sentimentalism, emotionalism, rationality, and analysis, every one of those sabotage the relationship that God has and wants for each of us.
Yep.
I'm not saying there's anything wrong with any of it. It's human. I'm saying we can't substitute that for God.
Right.
You can't substitute getting excited for a genuine experience in God.
Right.
Nothing wrong with excitement. I mean, we experienced some here this morning. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying, you cannot think that just because something excites you or stirs your emotions or messes with your rationale that you've had an encounter.
Right.
Come on.
Yeah. Right.
There is no substitute for love.
No.
Right. There's no substitute for God.
Right.
God is love. And talking about such a relationship is easy. But just as we read here, there's a strange bedfellow to love, and that's fear. Mm-hmm. Only perfect love casts out fear. So God spoke to me and said, don't be afraid. Love will never leave you or forsake you. We've been given access to eternal love.
Yes. Right.
To the tree of God's life.
Thank you, Lord.
To the tree of love.
Right.
And it come in the person of Jesus, the Son of love.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. But here's where the rubber meets the road, everybody. Amazing how when Revelation starts to unfold, everything fits. Everything makes sense. If you read the Bible outside of the context of love, you're just going to get a bunch of rules and a bunch of regulations and a bunch of stuff that will just do nothing but condemn you and freak you out. But in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things that were made by Him. Everything that was made by Him. And without Him, nothing was made that was made.
Yes.
The Word became flesh and dwelt among us.
Yes.
And we beheld Him, the glory as of the only begotten of love. James 1, 22 through 25. Be ye doers of the word. The word is the son of love. The word is love.
Right.
He's not telling us emulate the works of Christ. He's telling us to emulate the love of God.
Yes.
And the works will take care of themselves.
Yes. Come on.
Yes.
Not peers only. Deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. He beholds himself and goes his way, straightway forgetting what manner of man he was.
Right.
2 Corinthians 3:18 just stretches that revelation a little bit further. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image, from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So we focus on love. We focus on Him. He, love, is known and experienced. And we get back to the garden. Mm-hmm. Back to the vine.
Yes. Right.
Back to the tree of life.
Right.
Back to the Father's love. And the result of that is back to our dominion.
Yes.
Back to our authority.
Yes.
Back to our supernatural.
Yes.
Back to eternal life.
Yes.
Back to God life.
Yes.
Back to the capacity to do what Jesus said,
yes.
Greater works
yes.
than these shall you do, because I go back to love.
Yes.
But I'll come back as the Spirit of love, and I'll dwell in you. I'm with you, but I will be in you.
In you. Yes.
And then you'll do greater works than I've done.
Yes.
And you'll do them the same way.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Jesus, glory.
We've been given the tree of life back. We've been given love,
yes.
the power to release the supernatural. It's in Christ, in the Son of Love, that all of this takes place.
Glory.
Can you say praise the Lord?
Yes.
Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thanks again, everybody. I appreciate you sharing what you did.
Yes.
It sets everything up for the love of God to minister and to move here through his branches. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Just stay connected to love,
yes.
and the fruit will come automatically, naturally.
Yes.
He'll give us all things.
Through
the Son, who loves us. Praise
yes.
God and gave himself for us. God bless you all. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great week.
You,
walk in love.
Yes.
See what God does. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.
I have a